join in our opening worship songs.
Try this 90-second trick to instantly reduce your winter energy bills by 85%. This jet engineer just discovered...
Well, let's sing together.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing, the mercy for all me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
Thank you.
bustle and wonder. Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce could take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, shall fill my heart, then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Father, we know on today and days like today how great you are. We are so thankful to be able to come into this worship space safely and freely and of our total choice. We ask that your Spirit would be with us this morning and that you would have a word from a very important saint in each and one of our lives, that we might hear that word from that saint today. We ask this in the risen Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. All right, for you fashionistas, because I know we have them out there, I totally get that this is not an appropriate fall outfit. I get it. But I don't know about you guys, but I am so tired of dressing like a man in orange all week for this hunting thing so that I cannot get shot while I'm out walking at my two little pups that I just decided I had to spring back into spring for just a couple hours. So please know I get it. You don't need to comment on my spring outfit. A couple of fun things we got coming up this week. We've got Charmaine's Supper, number 73. Carrie has already been ordering things for months. I got to watch like 18 cases of fresh bean sprouts show up from Amazon. I didn't even know Amazon had that many bean sprouts. She was in there cooking this morning and getting things ready, so I'm sure that we still have room for helpers. So if you haven't signed up or your schedule now allows you to help out, it's a wonderful mission project for our church, so please sign up. Second mission project that we have coming up is in a couple weeks on Monday, we're going to go over and serve the firefighters and their families a meal. And so I need people to help me cook homemade stuff and food. If you can do that, great. If you can do that and serve, great. If you can only serve, great. But we're going to start about 5:30 at the fire hall, so please sign up for that also. And then somebody was kind enough to tell me how mad they are at me because I moved the treats into the hallway. Now, the purpose in moving the treats into the hallway was to stop the jam up at the door and also to get you guys walking up and down both sides of the treats so that you can get your treat quicker. Who doesn't like a treat quicker? The idea was not to have you get a treat, get a cup of coffee, and boogie. No, this space is still open to visit. The library is open. The fireside room is open. Out here is open. You can stick around. The idea was not to make you leave. It was just to make things more efficient. Gary, is that okay for my explanation? Okay, he's shaking his head. All right, that's good. So please rise and let's now sing our more traditional opening songs.
Thank you.
Father, we once again thank you. We thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for our time together that we're able to come and to worship you. Lord, you are the great I am. And there are some times that we all forget that. But as we're traipsing through the woods in the upcoming weeks, whether we're hunting or whether we're collecting or gathering or just walking, we ask that you would lift up our eyes so that we can see you at work in nature, Lord. This morning we bring our transgressions, our trespasses, our sins before you, Lord, so that we can leave them in this place and have a much lifted heart and be much more joyful, Lord, when we leave this place. Lord, we pray for those folks on our prayer card this morning, Berkeley, Jaron, Merrill, Phil, Dan, and Racer, Carolyn, Kevin, Vicky, Gary, Paul, Nathaniel, and Mike. Lord, I heard a story this morning about Racer. He was actually able to hold a gun yesterday while Levi helped him shoot a deer. That is fabulous, Lord. And I also heard that Nathaniel is not only home, but he is able to walk down the steps at the pool and able to start swimming again. So Lord, your healing hand is working on all of us. Lord, we ask that you would hear our private prayers and petitions at this time. Lord, we ask that you take all of our prayers and petitions and we wrap them up into the prayer that your Son, Jesus, taught all of his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would our kiddos come forward and our young at heart? And young at body, it doesn't just have to be heart. Oh, we do have a fashionista here this morning. Oh, you look fabulous, my dear. Look at you. And you too. And you too, and you too, and you too. So, does anybody know what a saint is? When we say we're going to celebrate saints, what does that mean? Yes, saints were people who believed in Jesus. That is correct. What else about them? They're Christians, yep. And you know what? They died. So they're no longer with us. So when we say saints, they're sort of saints up in heaven with Jesus. So has anybody had a grandparent or a great-grandparent or somebody pass away in your family? Yep, that's kind of sad, isn't it? Well, if we could take those very special people. You know what, David, I'm getting a little back feet here. If you could maybe turn me down to teach. Thank you. If we could put those special people right here in front of us, those people that we've lost, do you think they'd have something to teach us? Yeah, they would. What do you think they'd teach us that would maybe help us live better lives on earth? They could teach us about Jesus, you bet. They could teach us about God. Yeah. What else might they teach us that would be helpful in life? Pardon? They could teach us about the great Jehovah. Yes, that's a big word for a little girl. Could they teach us maybe to be kind? They could teach us about Noah, who built the ark. So they could teach us all kinds of things, but you know the most important thing they could teach us? You already talked about. And that's to have faith. To have faith in Jesus Christ and in God and in the Holy Spirit. Because there's a story in the Bible, and I forgot to look it up this morning, not like I didn't have the time, about a gentleman who died and didn't go to heaven. He went to the other hell place. And he prayed out to God, please, 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 let me come back and tell my family that you are real so that they don't end up in hell with me, that they end up in heaven. And you know what God said? Nope, they got to figure out themselves. So I think it's really important if the saints can help us understand how important it is to believe in Jesus so that we can ensure that we get to be in heaven with Jesus. Yep. Yeah. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the saints that have gone before us. We ask that you would continue to surround us with them, because we know they are around us all the time. We just need to open up our eyes and our ears and to listen for them. So we ask that you would do that and that we could still hear special messages from those who we have lost and can see no more. Amen. Amen. You guys can sit down.
Thank you.
recognition of All Saints Sunday, we would like to read the names of our saints who we have lost in the last 12 months. Marilyn Diedrich. My mom, Ben Helling. Elizabeth Lingle. Evelyn Brentlett. Geraldine Spanier. Jeanette Greeley. Helen Lehman. Merlin Krepke. Cliff McCain. Cliff McCann. Pam Nisler. And Marilyn Simpson. Lord, we pray for those that we can no longer see, but we know are already resting in your arms, in the arms of Jesus. Lord, we commend them to you as much as we miss them. We know that they are in a very special place in heaven. Amen. So this morning, we're going to expand on the children's message a little bit, and we're going to talk about things that we can learn from the saints who went before us. And last Wednesday, when I was with the kiddos, we had an exercise, and kind of like what we did this morning. They all thought of a saint, and they put the saint in front of them, and we talked about things that we could learn from the saints. And they had some really fun comments. And we talked about the fact that today, you know, we live in such an internet fast-paced world, we think we can only learn things online. Well, we can learn many, many more things and stories about Jesus, stories in the Bible, stories about our family, all kinds of stories, if we just sit down and spend time with those people we love, our family and our friends. And one of the first things that the saints have taught us is how to be active. You know, Jesus walked throughout his entire ministry, from here to there and back again. And I suspect that he was probably in pretty good shape, and along with his followers. And you know, if you think about it, they didn't have nice Nike tennis shoes with all the support. They were walking in old, crappy leather sandals. So they had a lot of work to do to stay in shape. But I think what we can learn is that we don't have to park right next to the front door of the store at Teals. You know, Teals has a huge parking lot. Those of us who can move can park out in the back 40, kind of like I do on Sundays at church, and we can walk in and get some exercise. I think there's probably not one person who's been on their deathbed who would say they wished they would have exercised less. I doubt it. Second thing we can learn from the saints is how to have purpose. Now, Jesus had a very clear purpose for his life, to make as many disciples as humanly possible so that all of us could enter the kingdom. That was his main purpose. But he also wanted to emulate a life well lived. A life of kindness, of humility, of inclusivity, even of people that looked and acted and sounded and smelled very different from Jesus. And although Jesus didn't really get to live long enough to be what I would call an elderly gentleman in our society, he taught us a lot about having purpose. You know, and our purpose, we have one purpose in life, really, the most important one, and that is to make more disciples for Jesus Christ. How we do that is different for each and every one of us. Some of us are kind. Some of us reach out to our neighbors. Some of us drive folks to and from doctor's appointments. Some people have musical talents. Some people have AV talents. Some people can read scripture. Some people can teach. It doesn't matter what your talent is. Have a purpose and use it. And then laughter. Laughter is truly the best medicine. Doctors tell us that time and time again. And if you had any saints in your life with a sense of humor, you know how fun it is. And sometimes, you know, you can witness the craziest behaviors and you say to yourself, oh my gosh, I can't laugh at that today, but you know, maybe in 2 months or in 2 years, I'll be able to laugh at it because it's pretty doggone funny. Well, we have a saying in our family, if you can laugh at it down the road, you might as well laugh at it today, because it's not going to be any funnier 2 years from now than it is today. And think about Jesus. Jesus had to have had a sense of humor. He saw and witnessed some of the most bizarre behaviors, not only from priests, but from other folks. You know, his disciples weren't the smartest bulbs on the tree. You know, they were picked for their heart, not necessarily their brains. I mean, sometimes he had to just want to tear his hair out and go, really, folks? How many more times do I got to tell you this? So he had to have had a sense of humor. And we know he did, because he told parables to people who would never understand it in a million years. But yet his followers were there, and his followers understood the parables. And if they didn't, Jesus took the time afterwards to explain what it meant. But I'm sure in their groups in the evening at supper after a day of teaching, they must have gotten a good belly laugh at all the people who didn't understand those parables. And how much fun he made out of other people, particularly the priests. And then the saints can teach us to value friendship. In our scripture reading this morning, is a story about Lazarus, who was one of Jesus' very near and dear friends. So let's hear a bit about that story on how we can value friendship.
Good morning. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary, and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom loves you is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God might be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and you are going to go there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Here ends today's reading.
So you see, Jesus understood the value of friendship. He knew that Mary and Martha and Lazarus were some of his best friends. And although he didn't get back in time for Lazarus' death, you know, and scripture says mostly because he wanted to be able to raise him from the dead, show the miracle, and try to create more believers, he might also have just been too doggone busy to get back in time. So he knew the value of friendship, and we all know how that story ends. He does go back. He does go out to Lazarus' tomb. He does raise Lazarus from the dead. And he does reinstate his friendship not only with Lazarus, but with Mary and Martha. And we're told in Scripture that many, many more believed because of that particular miracle. Now, we know how much we value friendship and interaction. You know, God didn't create us to live in a little silo by ourselves. And we all remember at the height of COVID, it was really hard. I remember living in South Minneapolis, and I remember, you know, it was really hard. I couldn't go to work. I hardly could go to the grocery store. You know, really the only interaction I had was with people walking their dogs. And I remember how silly it was. We'd be outside walking our dogs, and we'd have masks on. And I would think, what in heaven's name is this about? But it doesn't matter, because I get to, like, have a face-to-face with a person. And you all remember, it was a hard time. So we were created to be in community, to live together, and not to be a solo act. And then the saints, I think the most important thing that they can teach us is how to find faith. You know, everybody in my family before me were pretty religious and spiritual. They worked and volunteered at church. We raised up our families knowing Jesus. My grandfather was on the church council for a billion years, and my grandmother ran the ladies' aid group at that time. My dad and my uncle were ushers. My aunt played the organ, and my mom ran the coffee. We were a churched family. So faith is the strongest form of hope by definition. And it's believing in things that we haven't seen. And it's so, so important that we do that. The kiddos and I had a really tough conversation on Wednesday. And I don't even remember how it got brought up. But the question came up about good deeds or good works and faith. So I asked the kiddos, and they were like, six of them that I had that day, sixth graders, and then I had a couple of sophomores. And I posed the question, do you guys think that a person that does good deeds and good actions but doesn't believe in Jesus, do you think they can get to heaven? And oh, they weren't sure about that. They had to think about it. And finally, somebody said, no, they can't get to heaven, can they? And I said, no, the Bible is very, very clear about that. That the first thing you need to do in order to get into heaven and live with Jesus and God eternally is to have faith in Jesus Christ. There are so many times in the Bible where it says you get to heaven through Jesus. You can't skirt around him. You gotta go right up with him. Now, there are many other places in the Bible that says, you know, faith without works is dead. Well, what that means is that good works and good deeds and being a nice person is a natural result of our faith. But good deeds and good works alone will not get you into heaven, which is exactly what that guy in the Old Testament was trying to ask God for. Hey, I know I'm in hell. I blew it. I am not ever going to get to heaven. Please let me go back and tell my brothers about this whole Jesus thing. So that obviously would have been the New Testament, not the Old Testament. Let me go tell them about Jesus. And let me spare them having to live in hell for eternity. And Jesus, or God, or the Spirit said, no, doesn't work that way. You can't end up in the wrong place and then go back and pull your relatives into heaven. They have to get there on their own. So the saints that went before us, they would tell us how important faith is. Be grateful. Everybody's led different lives, and they have different lots in life. At this point, it's easier to not be happy with what you have and to want more than to just be satisfied with what we have. But nobody better will teach us how to be grateful than the elderly. It was interesting yesterday. I was got up in the morning, and first thing that popped up on my Facebook page was Pastor Jerry Jensen, who was my associate pastor in Bloomington. It was his birthday, and it was his 87th birthday. The guy's old. And so I sent him a text, and I said, "Happy birthday, dude. I really miss you. Hope you're having a great day." And didn't necessarily expect to have a conversation with him. And I got a text right back that said, "Yeah, I'm home from the hospital. The stroke wasn't that bad." And I went, "Oh, my God." Picked up the phone, and I called his home because he's got one of those little machines that lets him see what I'm saying, because sometimes I get excited and talk too fast for him. And we had a 27-minute conversation, and we laughed, and we yucked it up about his stroke. He has a sense of humor, and he is grateful to be alive. I said, "Geez, Jerry, how did it happen?" He goes, "Well, I was standing up, and all of a sudden I got dizzy, and I fell to the ground." I said, "Did you land on anybody?" He goes, "No." I said, "Did you break anything?" He goes, "No." I said, "Well, praise God." He goes, "Yeah, I just kind of slit my eye open a little bit. You know, I bleed a lot, but had a few stitches, not a big deal." And I had all these tests, and he went through this whole litany of tests that he had had since then, and we were yucking it up. I said, "Well, Jerry, obviously God's not done with you because you're still here." And he said, "I know. I know." That man was grateful. 27 minutes later, I hung up the phone, and my cheeks hurt from laughing. And then the saints can teach us, it's never too late to learn. You're never too old to learn. Jesus and his disciples, they ministered to young people, old people, middle-aged people, different races, different ethnic backgrounds, different physical and mental deficiencies, different financial status. It didn't matter. They gathered all the people they could find, and they taught them about Jesus. So it's never too late to talk about Jesus. I've talked about Jesus to people on their deathbeds who said, "I gotta find out about this Jesus. I'm running out of time." And I'd say, "Yeah, you are. Let's get talking." Never, never too late to learn. And the saints would absolutely tell us that. And listening to each other. When you have spent this many years on earth, you know that you have many experiences and stories. David, can you flip my picture one, please? There's my little people, I love them. So more often than not, you know, all of our stories are different. But how fun is it to sit down with an elderly person and hear their stories? And now it's, you see this happen more and more as somebody's really sick or knows they're gonna be sick. You know, people start using their iPhones and they tape stories so that they don't lose the stories because they're so important. And Jesus used stories all the time. He used parables to teach us the things that we needed to learn. And yes, they might have used some agrarian terms back then or some examples that maybe don't make sense to us who kind of live in the city or in more rural communities, but they got them back then when they all lived on the farm. It doesn't matter. We can still use those same stories today. Second to last, they will teach us how to plan ahead. You know, if we could have those saints in our lives right here, and if we ask them, "How well do you think you planned for your death?" I think many of them would say, "Probably pretty doggone well." When my mom went into hospice, we knew the song she wanted sung. We knew for years ahead that McHale's had to cater it. And we knew exactly what food she wanted and exactly what she wanted everybody to drink. You know, we didn't know we'd have to deal with COVID, but we figured it out. I mean, she planned ahead. So we knew exactly what was going on. Well, Jesus certainly planned ahead. He knew exactly how many days, hours, minutes, and seconds he had to do his ministry. And I suspect he used every single moment. Every single moment. You know how some of those saints we see who have used every minute of their life and every ounce of energy, and they just die because their bodies and brains give up. They just wore out. I don't know about you, but man, when I leave this earth, I want to be worn out. Worn out from talking about Jesus and doing Jesus' good work. And lastly, I think the saints would teach us how to be positive. How to be positive teachers. Jesus knew that by delivering a positive message, it would be way more inspirational than dwelling on the fire and the hell and the brimstone of hell. Yes, hell exists. Of course it does. Yes, it's a horrible place. Of course it is. But Jesus just didn't talk that much about it. He spent more of his time being inspirational and teaching us how to take care of each other on his earth, how to do good creation care, and how to make sure that we had a strong faith so that we went to heaven. So many lessons that we can learn from the saints that have gone before us. So during the upcoming week, while you're out in the woods or not, I'd like to have you think about a special saint and a lesson that they tried to teach you, but maybe you didn't hear it, or maybe a lesson that you can now open your eyes and ears as you look back to hear it, and see if you can't emulate that gift and turn it into your life to make your life better. That's the takeaway I want for you today. Amen. All right, so this morning we're going to celebrate Holy Communion. And I'm getting better at this. What you guys have convinced me is there is nothing new under the stars. So we're going to go back several years ago when Pastor Rick was here, and I remember doing communion this way. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to have our communion servers, all of our musicians, and David, that's you too. We're going to come down and we're going to celebrate Holy Communion. Then what's going to happen is we're going to have the ushers usher you, and you need to follow the Fuchses this morning, because they're going to have this side come, we're going to have communion, then they're going to have this side come and have communion. So we're going to see if we can't make it flow a little bit more smoothly than it has since I've been here. So please let us be in a time of prayer for Holy Communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him and who earnestly repent of their sin and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, broke it, passed it out to his disciples and followers and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Please do this in remembrance of me. Remember what I did for you on the cross over 2,000 years ago." And then he took the cup, blessed it, raised it to his Father, gave it to his followers, and said, "Drink this. This is my blood shed for you. This is what I did for you on the cross." As you continue to celebrate Holy Communion, please remember what I have done for you. So as we prepare the table for you, please be in a time of prayer. Diane, would you bring me a hand sanitizer when you guys come down? So when my workers, musicians, and folks come down here and we'll do communion, and then we'll start to serve it to the congregation. Let's see, you guys are gonna come up. Let's see, where's Helen? Oh, you're right there. David, you wanna come down? Okay. The body of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ shed for you. And the body of Christ shed for me. Blood of Christ shed for you, and the body, blood of Christ shed for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you, and the blood of Christ shed for me. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Jeannie, could you come up and help me do communion? Thank you. about all the activities and things that you're going to do this week. Think about how you can be the hands and feet and mouthpiece of Jesus to help people to Christ so we can all celebrate in heaven together. Amen. About your week. Think about ways that you can be the hands and feet of Jesus and be welcoming and be kind. Amen. Thank you. pray that all of you this week will remember kneeling at this altar and praising Jesus. So praise him with your works and your deeds and your faith this week. Amen. Ushers, please come forward for our offering. Thank you. us with the ringing of the bell, and we will ring it as we complete our service just prior to our singing of the last song. Jesus this week. Amen.